Hello, everybody. I'm Alistair Forsyth, and this is the first episode in our introductory mini course into discrete calculus with the Wolfram Language. This is the first episode, What is Discrete Calculus? Discrete calculus is the study of sequences using tools such as finite differences, sums, products, and generating functions. Here are two examples of such sequences, an arithmetic series and a geometric series, with a common difference and a common ratio of 3, respectively. An understanding of these sequences, series, and the tools we use to manipulate them is the basis for modern calculus. Sums are just one of the tools we use here. Sigma notation can be a powerful tool to express summations of infinite elements in a compact and readable way. Here we have an example of a simple finite sum. This notation just takes each integer k from k equals 0 to k equals 5 and takes their sum. If we evaluate that cell, we get 15, which makes sense given that 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 is equal to 15. Here are two examples of infinite sums. The first one sums up 1 over 2 to the power of k for every integer k greater than 1. If we evaluate this one, it comes out to be 1. This next one takes the sum of 1 over k factorial for all integers k greater than or equal to 0. When we evaluate this one, it comes out to be Euler's constant. One example of how we use these infinite sums is Riemann sums. Here, we have plotted just a fairly simple curve. Here, we use the discrete plot function in the Wolfram language to create a Riemann sum for this curve. This Riemann sum is a midpoint approximation, taking rectangles a third of a unit long and setting their height equal to the height of f of x at the middle of that rectangle. Taking the sum of the volume of each of these rectangles, we get an approximation of the integral of f of x over that area, which comes out to be around 2.04. We can also take the limit of that approximation as the number of chunks grows without bounds and see that it comes out being equal to the integral of f of x dx from 1 to 3, which is the range that we cover with that approximation. Along with sigma notation, we use pi notation to evaluate products of infinite elements in a compact manner. We can use pi notation to express important contents, like this awful equation. When we evaluate it in the Wolfram language, it comes out to be, wait for it, pi. We can also use pi notation to create definitions for simple functions. For example, if we take the product of every integer k from 1 to a given x, it comes out to be the factorial of x. Using sigma and pi notation together, we can generate some interesting functions. For example, here, we have a unique definition of the binomial coefficient of n, k. Evaluating this in the Wolfram language, we can see that it comes out to the correct value for the binomial coefficient of 10, 3. A keen eye might notice that this is actually just using the factorial definition written in pi notation and the normal definition of the binomial coefficient of n, k. Using some techniques to simplify this, we can get a slightly different definition that no longer resembles the original definition. When we evaluate this and the normal definition, they all come out to be identical. Along with that, we can use infinite sums to generate functions known as Taylor series. Here, we use sigma notation to write out two fairly famous infinite Taylor polynomials, which come out to be the same as sine and cosine of x. We can also use pi notation to write out similar approximations, but ones that aren't actually Taylor series. Evaluating these in the Wolfram language takes a little bit longer, but it still comes out to be sine and cosine of x. Another tool we use to examine sequences is finite differences, which function as discrete calculus's analog of a derivative. Here, we have a function, just a random polynomial, and we can write out a forward definition, backward definition, and central definition of a finite difference. Here we plot out the function to get a better sense of what it looks like. Then, let's examine the different values of these forward, backward, and central definitions. They each look a little bit different, but they serve a similar purpose. If we take these finite differences and scrap the finite part, we can see that no matter which definition you use, if you take the limit as h approaches 0 or a approaches 0, you'll just get the derivative of f of x. Now, you've reached the end of this first video. We looked at discrete calculus as the study of sequences and series and the basis for modern calculus. We looked at sigma and pi notation, which can be used to evaluate sums and products of infinite elements. and we looked at finite differences as the discrete calculus's analog of derivatives. In the next presentation, we'll go over prime numbers and some of their applications and properties. And the preparation slides and practice problems for this lesson will be available for download on the course page. Along with that, we have a list of additional resources that you can look at for this lesson. Again, I'm Alistair Forsyth, and thank you for watching. Bye-bye.